Coyote.
Well, I just wanted to say a few things in light of what happened this past weekend. I know I speak for all the Jehovah Waitresses when I say that our generation hasn't had a lot of heroes, and we lost a really important voice when we lost Kurt Cobain on Friday. And it seems that in our society, an overriding sense of commercialism chews those heroes up and spits them out. And it's going to be pretty quiet without that voice. So let's keep listening to the voice that he did leave us, and let's start making some noise of our own.
Wow. Okay. Powerful words from the waitresses, Linda Roy, Kevin, and everybody. Wow. Okay. Moment of silence for Kurt before we get into the show. Okay, here's an hour-long special, a tribute to Kurt Cobain on 107.9 The End.
I'm not like them, back in the town. The sun is gone, and I have a light. The day is done, and I'm having fun. I think I'm dumb, maybe just happy. Think I'm just happy.
I've never wanted the fame involved. That's a totally different story.
Good morning. This is Officer Vanette Tissue with the Seattle Police Media Update Information Line for April 8th, Friday, and the time is 11:45 a.m. We had an incident today where the police were called to 171 Lake Washington Boulevard East. In this incident, an electrician...
I think young people today just feel bad. They feel alienated. They feel hopeless. They don't feel good about their future. And Kurt Cobain was, and it feels really strange to be saying was, but he was definitely one of those people.
She called me up. It could have been the night that he died, because he was missing from, like you said. Well, Courtney called me up to see if he was at my house, and which is weird, because, I mean, he's never been to my house. And, but I guess I was somewhere close by, and she got my number. And she was saying, you know, all this stuff, like, I mean, all the pressures that I'm talking to you about, that's what she was kind of telling me that the guy had, you know, going on.
He had scoliosis.
Yeah.
He had a horrible stomach pain. I'm sure it was very bad. And I think it just contributed to his idea of the world and even down to his body as a hostile, painful place.
Voice of a generation. I mean, you know, Bob Dylan, he was given that, but he passed it off. Because who's going to take that on, you know, and pull it off?
He is one of these brilliant songwriters that would write these incredible pieces of music just packed with pain.
The King County Medical Examiner has positively identified the body of Kurt Cobain by fingerprints. The autopsy has shown that Kurt Cobain died of a shotgun wound to the head, and at this time, the wound appears to be self-inflicted.
Inside your heart-shaped box, oh.
Cobain, Chris Novoselic, and Dave Grohl. In just a few years, they've sold millions of albums, won a couple of dozen awards, and revolutionized the sound of radio. Nirvana, that legend in progress, ended today with the death of Kurt Cobain. We're going to hear from people who worked with the band, identified with the band, the people who were the band. We're going to listen to a Westwood One live concert and hear some of their great MTV Unplugged performance. Let's take the next hour to remember an amazing band and an amazing man.
Nirvana is a band that is a legend here. I mean, they are the band that put this town on the map, so to speak. And kids are very upset right now. You know, we've had people calling us on the air who are crying, who are very torn up about this whole issue. You know, one of the premier songwriters of the decade is gone. And I think that's having a pretty devastating effect.
Marco Collins, music director from Seattle's The End.
Seems like the media and the record label smell something hot, and they jumped on it. And I think major, like, media and labels jumped on Seattle as a commodity, and things get kind of twisted in the process.
Chris Novoselic.
We toured with Mudhoney. Our first show was in, they took us down to Portland once to open for them, and there was this poster that said, you know, Satyricon, Mudhoney, and Nirvana. It was like N-I-R and the space V-O-N-A. It was like, but they brought us down to Portland, and that was our first show out of state, out of town, and had a really good time. That was like at the infancy of the Seattle scene. When I had the fondest memories of, I think that was like the real Seattle scene. I mean, played a lot of shows at the Vogue, at the Underground, and New District. That was really great.
Kurt Cobain.
But nothing really exciting happens on tour. People think that the rock star life is so exciting, but it's, you know, you play a show. You usually get into the town by the time it's dark, and you sound check, and you don't get to see the city. You play the show, and then you leave the next morning. You know, you go to the hotel room, and you leave, and do the same thing over and over again. It's kind of boring, in a way. I mean, still, I can't think of anything else I'd rather do, but it's not as exciting as everyone thinks.
This goes to all the people here. It's like, remember what Neil Brenner said, whatever you do, don't smoke.
St. Thomas, program director of WFNX in Boston.
I actually interviewed him right after they played Saturday Night Live the first time. And I just always thought, you know, he's a very meek, kind of shy, friendly guy. And very opposite of what came out of him on stage and through his music. I mean, when he wasn't playing music, he was just so kind of like feeble. And I always thought he was very gracious, too.
Down, down, down.
somebody that put out the first record and sold like 30,000 copies, made the second album, had no idea what was about to happen, sells like 9 million records, and suddenly is called like the voice of a generation. And I think that that's really hard for somebody to handle all of that. People can...
Rape me, rape me, my friend. Rape me, rape me again.
Melissa Etheridge called in before she took the stage tonight in Ames, Iowa.
And so I set out in the beginning with that in mind, and I set out and started, you know, working and on my dream. And as I got every little step going along, I realized when I got my first album and put it out that, you know what, no, the problems do not go away. That if you're not settled in yourself, everything else isn't gonna, you know, go away magically. And these demands that people put on you and what people want you to be, and if you're not grounded yourself, you get pulled really easily by what people think and what people say. And I found that I had to go in and, yes, years of therapy and years of dealing with myself and my own problems on my own level before I could get out there in front of thousands of people every night and then present that and enjoy it and love it for just what it is, which is just entertainment.
Yeah. To live up what you think the public's expectation is of you, what your own personal expectation might be with the art that you're creating, and it's a very, very sensitive balance between the two.
Porno for Pyro's manager, Paul V.
People just really have to realize that, like I said earlier, these are just human beings who happen to, you know, be in the public spotlight And it is easy for the public to want to live the decadent life through their you know, quote-unquote rock stars or whatever the case may be.
But it's just like I don't go out of my way for like publicity and
right.
this kind of this publicity stuff. And the reason I decided to talk to you is because, like I say, you know, first off, because I've had suicides in my family, and I just don't want a bunch of people just all of a sudden just, you know, claiming, hey, let's just go, you know, it's the way to go. I mean, I'm not gonna hold nobody back on this planet. If they really think this planet's so lousy, they might be right. I mean, I'm not going to lie to you. They might know something that I don't.
From Porno for Pyros, Perry Farrell.
I've gone through periods of feeling extreme depression because of a situation that should be like, I mean, literally, he should have been in Nirvana, but, you know, it was pretty ironic. dealing with fame has got its ups and its downs, and you have to grow with it very slowly in order to make it, you have to take steps back from it and look at it and kind of manipulate it and play with it and push it around and see which way you want it to shape for you, and not let it to, like, engulf you. Like, if it was a live blob of silly putty, that's what fame would be like in my eyes. And if you don't play with it, or, you know, play around with it and give it a chance, I mean, you've got to give your life a chance to unwind and get used to these changes that hit you. I mean, if you think about his lifetime, he had 20-something years to live, and then how many years of all of a sudden were fame. What comes on in fame brings, I mean, everything in life has got a downside to it, right? You know, you've got the upside of the pendulum and the downside. Well, to have incredible fortune and fame instantly brings also there's some instant tragedies that occur. You lose a lot of your freedom. For a kid who looks like he was just a very carefree kid, to give up, you know, walking on the street, or even something as minor as going to a club, you wouldn't imagine, like, being able to go to a club means a lot to guys like, you know, myself, and I'm sure to him. And to not be able to just walk into a club and be one of the kids, I mean, he looked like he very much wanted to maintain that.
I'm not a pawn that can pretend. The sun's gone, the heavy light. The day's done, the heavy pawn. I think I'm done, maybe just happy. Think I'm just happy. Think I'm just happy.
Judged at all for your own merits, and it throws your head upside down. I'm not saying woe is me or pity the famous man. You know what I mean? I mean, anybody who gets fame in their life, if they deserve it, then they are definitely blessed, and they should only look at their life as blessed. I mean, if you really want my opinion, I don't know the situation, you know. I don't know the circumstances on why a guy would want to do that. I don't know. I haven't heard about the letter or what the reason was. But I can only say that The reason better be a damn good one. The only one I can conclude is that if something happened within his love life, because I have felt that the pain of like being hurt over a loved one, somebody crossing you, that's you know, you expose your heart, you like literally do a surgical procedure on your heart and, you know, show them your inner, you know, the inner pump there, and then if somebody were to take it and just like, you know, give you a wound on your heart, sometimes I felt like it's almost unbearable, too unbearable to live.
Album wasn't a hit instantly. It was the type of thing where we're playing it on the radio and we slowly start to realize that this thing, this band, is going to change the way music is. We just start to look at each other and without saying anything, just nod. This band is going to make everything different. The garage sound, the do-it-yourself late 70s hard rock sound. It's just every era of rock just packed into this one band called Nirvana. And that guy, Kurt, could write incredible songs. Every single song was incredible.
Stuff yourself, found any words. Got so high, scratched it up there. Yeah.
Chadoff, executive director, Anacapa by the Sea, a rehab center in California.
I have had contact with him in the last few weeks, and I was trying to encourage him to seek treatment, and not only for his chemical issues, which were well known, but for some of the underlying psychological pain and trauma that he was experiencing, and which really fueled his self-sabotage. That's not unusual. I mean, I've dealt with many patients who are in the same situation, both in and out of the rock and roll world, and it's particularly difficult to have these unresolved childhood issues that frequently fuel the addictive process.
there's just so much corruption going on with the government, and the Reagan years have definitely set us back to where the average teenager feels kind of lost and there isn't much hope. They're still at least aware of the mistakes that our parents' generation has made. And I just think that it'll take a little bit of time for kids to start doing the duties that they're supposed to do, which is challenge things like corruption. I'll never get over the shock, and that's kind of good.
It was sort of a really, whatever, organic thing. There wasn't any massive hype.
I mean, there was definitely no big million-dollar investment in promotion behind this record at all. It's totally organic, and it just happened.
You know, whatever's happened was surely out of our control, and I'm glad it happened. You know, it's nice to sell that many records. It's nice to turn on people as something different. People telling me, oh, yeah, you guys' record, I think you guys are going to go platinum. We're like, oh, man, come on. You know, if we get a gold record out of this, that'll be amazing.
This Westwood One remembrance of Kurt Cobain was produced by Marsha Richardson with Kate Coyer, Steve Futterman, Melanie Minear, Ben Harris, and Sue Waller, with engineering by Fred Lindgren and Ron Harris. Special thanks to Rob Tonkin, Ron Steffen, and Ron Lafitte. Executive producer for Westwood One, Norm Pattis. I'm J.J. Jackson. If you or someone you care about needs help, you can call Anacapa by the Sea, 1-800-487-8373. Or the Hazelden Foundation, 1-800-257-7800. From Edna St. Vincent Millay, we leave you with this thought. The candle burns at both ends. It will not last the night. But, oh, my friends, and ah, my foes, it burns a pretty light.
A special end concert series here on 107.9 The End, a tribute to Kurt Cobain, brought to us over the Westwood One Radio Network. And, if there's anyone out there who is unfortunately thinking that the only way out is killing themselves, it's a cop-out, because you leave so many people behind and you hurt so many people, not just yourself. So don't do it. If you need help, go to your family, and don't take the cop-out way out. Don't cheat yourself and your family. Life is a good thing. no matter what it may seem right now. Okay, I'm Pat the producer, and coming up next, I've got requested Eleanor McAvoy.